We all know that music is a big part of African culture. We all enjoy it, we like to listen to it, we like to vibe out to it. So we're going to take a short break from all the speeches and give a warm welcome to the Intercultural Choir Harmony for Humanity with legendary South Sudanese artist Ajak Kwai.
Yeah. and this next song we're going to do is written by a woman called Andrea Watson, who's married to Valunga Koza, who they live in Melbourne. And so this is, it's not an African song, but it's a song that's about the nomadic relationship that people have who move around the earth. So I thought it's a beautiful song, just sort of like a chant. So this is written by Andrea Watson, who's now named Andrea Koza.
Here, I think it's very dangerous that we demonize all the time when young people got into trouble. And I would like to say this too, you know, to don't look too hard on the negative, because there's so many good things going on under the ground that we don't see. Young people got into trouble. It's not a good thing. It demolished the moral of the community, and I think it's important that we're aware of that. So I did my part from traveling around Australia, and I remember one time I was sitting in Queensland, and a guy said about, you know, a lot of people, and he said, don't let that woman change your mind. And I said, where I got the power, mate? But I love Australia. Australian people are beautiful people. But just remember, you know, we're here, you know, because we love Australia. And don't divide the community. Thank you.
Everybody, I know that you are all incredibly important people. but we have really important people also speaking here, and I'd like that we have their full attention on the podium when they are sharing their messages with us. So please, please tell your publicist to call you at a different time because you can't make that photo shoot today. Keep your phones on silent. I'm not going to ask you to turn them off, like I said, because you're in front of people, but please respect those who are here presenting for us today. And if you are moving outside or commuting throughout the building, please try and keep your noise level down as much as possible. There is filming going on. If you see cameras, please give them space. They are supposed to be here. Great. I would now like to invite Professor Fetien Abay, representing Victoria University's Women in Science and Engineering. Can you please make her welcome?
Challenge of climate change and also civil war, which means that we are working in a very challenging environment where we have also 35% of female-headed households. I am a plant breeder. I came from male-dominated profession. Historically and globally, plant breeding, women were not allowed to be employed in plant breeding. So that when the first American woman invented the issue of jumping genes, the mutation, she was employed as a botanist because she was not allowed to be a plant breeder. And she is really my mentor to follow, even if it's a long years ago, I just started to feel very strong. But when you work in a very active climate change areas and drought, civil war, everything was really frustrating. And I can't show any change as a plant breeding and no recognition given as a female. Ethiopia is a very quiet country. We have traditions, norms, and values, and people are quiet. And women are more quiet, which means I can be considered as outlier here, speaking here as an Ethiopian woman. You don't see Ethiopian women coming up because of the cultural setting and values. Most of them are very good, aligned with many countries, but some of them, they keep us to be a little bit inferior in terms of competition and coming up to fit with competitive global requirements, especially academically and scientifically. So I believe when I did my master's in the University of Wales in UK, I did my master's in rural resource management, and I said I don't like this one, what's about people, what's participation, because coming from agricultural research, and I feel like only the basic science are the most important scientific fields, and the other social science components are not considered as part of science. Then I said I should not spend my time. I don't like this master's program. And it was because of my superior has really instructed me to do that course. And because of that course, I am here. And I really like it because it is a course who really give me to show respect, like what was told by the elder in the morning, showing respect for people, showing respect, and being inclusive for every step of my day and my work. So I'm a person, I'm the first woman employed in Mekelle University. We started our university under the tree after the war. And being the only woman for so many years, as if No competent women are ready for employment. Accessful employment was not an easy. So the government has to make decisions, and also university management has to make decisions. We are one of the pioneer university that we consider ourselves, we are the University of Inclusiveness. And we did legislative-based decisions to provide access for employment for women. Because I did a study across 15 African countries, considering West African, East African, and North African, or Horn African countries, Ethiopia was the second in providing employment for educated people, which is next to Nigeria, and makes the country great. Because when a country believes on educated people, that means it's in the right direction, which I also feel very comfortable. But when you see it in terms of where are the women, because if you have a component of inclusiveness in your system, you ask this question. And then women were not there. They were 6% out of 1,300 or 1,500 employees, if you find 6% women. Comparing to South Africans, 41%, and West African, even the small countries, were much better. And Ethiopia, I really give the name, Ethiopia is the tail of Africa in terms of women in sex. So that was really triggering the decision makers in the government. And we did a decision to make an incentive of competent women to open up our door for the university. And we have really increased by 40% the employment. So there used to be, 2 years ago, there used to be 137 female, and now we have more than 420. This year, we gave a prize which amounts 860,000 of Ethiopian birth in my university. 1,385 women scored more than 3.25. And then 20 of them scored 4 GPAs. I'm not alone. Because I was standing like a single tree in that university. And a single tree, I like the word that was given by the mayor that we have to promote diversity. And a single tree cannot make sense. When I traveled to different countries all over the world except Australia, I never found Ethiopian scientists, women scientists, not men, but women scientists. I really feel wrong because we need to be also part of, because Ethiopia is very big country. It is 3 times France in terms of area. Population-wise also, it's the second country in Africa, more than 100 million. So it's not a question of political right I'm talking now. It's a question of providing opportunities and also ensuring participation of women, improving the system, and also we have an agenda of transforming the country. And if 50% of the innovation pool is missed out, then any country cannot grow. And I did my PhD in Norway, where they have a very active, you know, women's issue, like I had in Australia, also the same thing, which I'm very glad with it. And I felt there is a common setting in Australia, which is more decent, like also the Scandinavian countries are. I feel this country should be good on that. So you see what is happening. When I started my research in the northern part of Ethiopia, there was no improved variety. And farmers were suffering only 2 tons per hectare they were producing. And that is not sufficient for people with big farming. And my job was very, very frustrating because I cannot achieve. This year I produced a variety, immediately it failed. My position was very frustrating. And I said I have to move on to the central part of Ethiopia, where I can show my success. And there was an Italian professor, retired now, He was really working for CG Center in Canada. He was very much affiliated here in Australia. And he told me the first time he came to my region, it's a very mountainous area. He said he has seen all the diversities, different varieties maturing in different parts. It looks like you put different diversity for purpose of decoration or botanical garden, but it wasn't. And he said, a crop closest to God, a barley breeder should not die before visiting the garden. Really? Do you think this area is useful? Yes, it is useful. The problem is you are not including the local people. You are not targeting the women. And I changed my strategy. And I include women farmers in my research. Now, I have 5 climate resilient varieties released as a technology. And yield has increased to $5. First time technology for the poor people. I am there 24 years being an African in Ethiopia. There are a lot of opportunities for better salary in life. I say, who is going to work for this lovely people? They are full of knowledge, full of diversity. Respecting diversity, sustaining diversity, is a safety net for the world, to feed the world, because we are a source of germplasm, source of genes for the world. That is the purpose of interdependence with people. I have a very specific example. We introduced rice for the first time in the northwestern part of Ethiopia, and that area was really had a problem. They couldn't grow a crop. It was highly waterlogged. And we introduced rice. They started to produce 7 tons per hectare. 7 tons per hectare as compared to 0.1 hectare for sorghum. And but they don't know how to do it. They don't know how to be husky. And they said, they complained to the government, please take over your crop. We cannot satisfy our hunger by looking at big hill. Can you take your crop, it's a wheat for us? That's what they said. Then women came in, experiment, start making, preparing the food out of this crop. Now the government gave it the name a crop of millionaire. Can you imagine? I have ever seen this kind of synthetic report to put the woman in the center of the innovation. We have varieties released for iron, high beta-glucan, and high nutritive values that is only cut up by women. In Africa, 70% of agricultural production is conducted by women. If you are working in dryland areas, the family head has to migrate for permanent and short-term life-making, and the women as a gender are responsible for agriculture. We always say agriculture is feminized in the dry part of Africa. In the post-harvest processing, the coordinator of the country, supported by USAID, 87% of the food safety management and post-harvest management is being conducted by women. But I have ever seen so much, visibly like other interventions which I support also, which is catering women. We don't really give, empower women, connect them with market, leading them to commercialize their knowledge, and so on. So most of the interventions, the support remains as a cosmetic, as a lip service level. Since I came from the grassroots level, all young sisters and brothers here, African and Australian, let us unite. Let us collaborate together. We are there at the grassroots level to provide support. I appreciate Dr. Mimi invited us that far long through the African diaspora. What can we do in Australia? It would have been nice if I invited, so that I promise as a vice president for research and community services. May I kindly ask for the Victoria University decision makers and Dr. Mimi to host at Mekelle University today, so that we invite African diaspora meetings and also changing it into action. So we are looking forward for your support. We need to share experiences. We need to update our knowledge. Human resource is the biggest capital for making changes. All these young ladies, I really give you an advice. Please give value for yourself. One of the biggest drawbacks for women, we don't give value for ourselves, we don't unite. It should not remain here. So don't be short-sighted. We have to start working in a very long vision. And I appreciate also the supportive management that I have noticed today, this morning, with the Victorian University here. And thank you very much, and thank you.
So thank you. Before you sit down, thank you so much. Can we please give her one more round? It's pioneering, and we appreciate you for that. Thank you so much for making the time as well to support us and participate us in this initiative that we're doing. And from the whole committee at Inaugural African Diaspora Women's Summit, we'd just like to present to you a small token of our appreciation.
Now, I would like to invite to the podium Councillor Catherine Cumming from the city of Maribyrnong.
Good morning, everyone. I feel like I'm home, but I know I'm in the city. I'd also like to acknowledge that we're in traditional lands, and I'd also like to acknowledge all the special guests. And I feel very privileged to be asked to come today to just speak briefly to inspire others in the room. For those who don't know me, my name's Councillor Catherine Cumming. I'm the Mayor of the City of Maribyrnong, which is the best council in Australia. And why I say that is that because I'm a Footscray girl. Born and bred. I went to St. Monica's School in Footscray. It had, at the time in the 70s when I went to that school, it had 108 children and 54 different nationalities. So that's pretty incredible. I did notice in the 70s that were the white policy. I did notice that. I remember talking to my teachers about it, because we were taught about what all the horrible things that we did to the Aboriginal community. But I did notice that we had a lot of new Vietnamese community coming in after the war, and I really was wondering where the Africans were. So that school was very inclusive. I was taught that we're all humans, that no matter where we came from, you helped each other. So the little Vietnamese children that came to the school who couldn't speak English, you just played with and you taught them English, and that's what you did. So let's fast forward my life a little bit. In year 11, I'm going to high school in Braybrook at Chisholm College, and I go to my careers advisor at that time, and I said to them, I don't think I'm very good at school. I struggle with spelling. You need to have very good marks to get into university. I think I'm going to leave. And the teacher said to me, have you ever even thought about you might have a learning disability? And I said, I don't know. Sat down, they tested me. I found out I was dyslexic. That my short-term memory is pretty much like a goldfish. I struggle remembering people's names. I can't spell to save my life. But then I was told by the person who had tested me that I had a very high IQ and I was very verbal. I loved to speak. And that there were opportunities for me not to leave school, but I could get special consideration. I would be able to use a dictionary. I could do my year 12 with a dictionary and virtually have headphones so I could read, I could hear what I was saying, so I didn't misread things. And at that time, I also had said to them that I had a love for natural medicine. I went to a naturopath in Footscray, and that naturopath gave me a love for natural medicine. And I found out that I could actually study natural medicine in colleges. There was a college in Camberwell. So I went off and I started studying Chinese medicine. Funnily, Victoria University picked up that course in the Kerner days, and I was then given the opportunity to go to university. Dyslexic from Footscray, being able to go to a university, and that university, Victoria University, was set up because they could see that there was a problem in the way that the children of the western suburbs weren't getting the opportunity to go to university. It was really just for the eastern suburbs kids. They didn't take me straight away. I had to be a mature age student. So I went and travelled a little bit and came back 21 mature and started my Chinese medicine studies. I got special consideration and was able to get through that. Funnily, depending on the subject that I did, if I really loved it, I got a high distinction. If I didn't, I just got a pass. But I got a degree and I was very happy. In my final degree, but what's even more funny about my little young life is that in my final year of uni, the council elections were coming along. I had a calico bag that flew down the street for my recycling. And I was working in a pub in Williamstown to get through my university, and they had a black bucket. And I thought, why is Williamstown so rich compared to Footscray? I'm going to run for council.
Wow.
I door knocked my area, and this is how I did it. And why I'm saying this to everyone here, because I am just a girl from Footscray, and anyone in this room can do what I've done easily. I door knocked my suburb, I was probably 24, with my girlfriend, who looked a bit like me, so she hit the other side of the street. Knocked on the door and said, "Hi, my name is Catherine, I'm running for council. If you vote for me, what would you like me to do for you?" And I got a long list. There's a street tree I don't like, there's this garbage bin that's missing, the park in my area needs fixing, there's this footpath, and I made this long list. Then I made that into a brochure and I put that out and said, if you vote for me, these are all the things that I've heard that I'll do for you if you elect me. I'm not sure if people know the political environment in Footscray, but Footscray's been very safe Labor, or the Western Suburbs has been very safe Labor for a very long time. And I really didn't understand politics at that stage. I ran as an independent. I wasn't part of a party. My only membership was for the Bulldogs. and I didn't understand politics. I got elected.
Wow.
And even I was still studying, so even my lecturers couldn't stop laughing that Councillor Cumming was sitting in the room. So I was a councillor, 24. And not really understanding much politics, but what I did know was that I loved Footscray and I loved the area I grew up, and that's how I could contribute. So in those meetings, I remember the CEO saying to me, "Are you left or right?" And I said, "What is left or right?" And he had to explain it, and I said, "No, I still think I'm a very much an independent." So yes, years of struggle onto council, learning politics, sticking up for my community as the best I knew. It took me 16 years to become the mayor because of being an independent. 16 years it took for my community to finally somehow believe that if we change our political environment in the western suburbs and possibly make it marginal, that's my mantra, I don't hate the Labor Party, I don't hate the Liberal Party, I don't hate the Greens, I don't hate, I think hate's an absolute wasted emotion. I just believe that if you actually give people a choice, and those choices are minor parties or independents or what have you, it gives diversity, and that diversity gives more voices, and those voices actually reflect the community better. I've always believed in politics that if you only had two football teams, you wouldn't watch football, and that's why people get sick of it, Labor, Liberal. I would too. For the broader community, I totally understand why politically they become disengaged when they haven't got the choices that they really need. So yeah, 16 years it took me to become the mayor, and 4 years later, lucky enough, I've become the mayor again. And I must say, my learnings of being on council for as many years that I have been, that I absolutely love this African community. I feel your struggles in the way that how the media is so disrespectful. They've done that to me numerous times, and I get it. They put one line, they twist your words, they do what they do. But we have to fight that. We have to become journalists, write our own stories. The African community also needs to be represented in Parliament, in state. Also to feel that women can do it too. I have been on council for 20 years. I have had my own personal struggles. I am single with 5 children. I became single 4 years ago after my relationship became abusive. And it can happen to anybody.
Yes.
Absolutely. But you know what? I organise babysitters. I hear from others who don't get it when you're single and you've got 5 children, somehow I should go home or I'm wasting money on babysitters to do my job. Really? No. I give my children the best opportunity to see someone who's working very hard, who at times, yes, I'm not there all the time, but you know what, I don't mind if they stay up a little late so they get to see me. And I wouldn't have it any other way. Absolutely. Even with every struggle that I've had over my life, it has taught me something. It has given me compassion to other people, and I get it. I get what it's like to struggle. I feel for the vulnerable in my community, the homeless. It's just a right, isn't it? You should have a house. But we need to support each other. We are one community. We're all humans. And the people who try to divide us in all different boxes by saying whatever, they're just so wrong. Thank you for your attention.